Welcome to Lecture 19. In this lecture, we will quantify electronic transitions in molecules, as well as reaction rates for photochemical reactions. This lecture will be broken down into two parts. In the first part, we will examine how and where electronic transitions occur. And in the second part, we will apply kinetics concepts to quantify the rate of photochemical reactions. The table in the slide summarizes what wavelengths of light stimulates what type of process. At the bottom of the plot are long wavelength photons, which produce spectroscopic effects like NMR, electronic spin resonance, rotational spectroscopy, and vibrational spectroscopy. It's as we shorten the wavelengths of light into the visible UV and X-ray range that we then stimulate electronic transitions. We have already quantified many examples of electronic transitions. For example, when discussing the hydrogen atom, we quantified the electronic transitions between energy levels using concepts developed by Bohr as well as the Schrödinger equation, which both gave similar results to the empirically determined relationship provided by the Rydberg equation. We have also looked at electronic transitions in molecules by examining the structure of the molecular orbitals. By exciting electrons in filled orbitals to empty orbitals, molecules absorb light and then re-emit it as the molecule relaxes. A chromophore is a chemical entity embedded within a molecule that absorbs radiation at nearly the same wavelength in different molecules. Common ones include the carbon-carbon double bond, where the transition is between an occupied pi orbital to an unfilled pi star orbital, and the carbon-oxygen double bond, where an electron in a non-bonding lone pair can be excited to an unfilled pi star molecular orbital. These two types of transitions are commonly observed in spectroscopy experiments in molecules with these functional groups. For the carbon-carbon double bond, the energy of the transition is about 7 electron volts, which corresponds to about 180 nanometers. This is in the ultraviolet part of the spectrum. If there is a conjugate chain, this energy of the transition drops into the visible region of the spectrum. For carbon-oxygen double bonds, the energy of the transition is about 4 electron volts, which corresponds to about 290 nanometers. This is in the ultraviolet part of the spectrum. The carbon-carbon double bond pi to pi star transition is typically more intense than the unbonded electron to pi star transitions. Electronic transitions seldom happen alone. There's a lot of energy involved in an electronic transition, and some of that energy can be used for lower energy transitions, such as vibrational transitions. The image in this slide is a representation of the ground state of a hydrogen molecule and the ionized hydrogen molecule after the absorption of a photon. There are two curves, and they both represent the electronic potential that the molecules exist in. They both have minima since there is an ideal intermolecular spacing between the two nuclei. Within each potential, there are a series of horizontal lines which represents the different vibrational states of the molecule. The vertical arrow represents the ionization of H2, where the molecule transitions from the ground state, both electronically and vibrationally, into an excited state. The electronic state is set by the electronic configuration. However, the vibrational state each H2 plus lands in is not certain. It's quantified by the plot on the right, where the counting rate for each excited vibrational state is plotted. In the figure, the most likely excited vibrational state is the second state. To quantify these transitions, we first return to the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. The Born-Oppenheimer approximation assumes the electronic motion and the nuclear motion in molecules can be separated. This leads to molecular wave functions that are given in terms of the electronic positions and the nuclear positions. This involves the following assumptions: that the electronic wave function depends on nuclear positions, but not upon their velocities, meaning that nuclear motion is so much slower than electronic motion that they can be considered to be fixed. And that, two, the nuclear motion, being rotation and vibration, sees a smeared out potential from the fast-moving electrons. Because of these assumptions, we can treat electronic and vibrational effects separately. The Frank-Condon principle states that transitions between electronic states correspond to vertical lines on an energy versus internuclear distance diagram. The Born-Oppenheimer approximation lets us assume that electronic transitions occur much more quickly than vibrational motions, because nuclei are much too massive to respond quickly. So when the electronic transition occurs, the equilibrium separation of the nuclei becomes the endpoint separation in the excited nuclear vibration. This looks like a vertical line drawn from the initial equilibrium separation to where a vibrational energy level meets the excited potential energy curve. As a result, multiple excited vibrational states could be selected. This process is illustrated on the figure on the left. Initially, the system is in the ground state, both electronically and vibrationally. When the photon comes in, it excites the system to another electronic state, illustrated by the second potential curve. However, notice that the arrow that represents the electron being promoted from the lower curve to the upper one goes from the minimum part of the bottom curve to the edge of the upper curve. This is the illustration of when the electronic transition occurs, the equilibrium separation of the nuclei in the ground state becomes the endpoint separation in the excited nuclear vibration. The fact that there is a window around the arrow is an illustration that several vibrational modes can be selected. The likelihood of an individual excited vibrational state to be selected is quantified using Frank-Condon factors. They are essentially the square of an overlap integral, denoted as S squared, of the wave function describing the initial vibrational state with the final vibrational state. Mathematically, this is expressed as S squared is equal to the magnitude squared of the integral from minus infinity to positive infinity of the complex conjugate of the wave function that describes the final vibrational state times the wave function that describes the initial vibrational state. Let's change focus and look at what happens when excited states relax and emit light. If a system is excited and then immediately relaxes, resulting in emitted radiation, then this process is called fluorescence. When spontaneous emission lasts for a longer period of time, this type of emission is called phosphorescence. The relaxation time is due to intersystem crossing before relaxation. The intersystem crossing is represented here as a spin flip of one of the electrons between, say, a singlet to a triplet. This is an uncommon event, so relaxation times are longer.